between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory. Cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my silence, the roaring lion, declare the grave.
Well, hallelujah, amen. He's arose, right? He is risen. He is risen indeed. I am so happy about that this morning. This is one of my favorite services as we come in and we celebrate today our risen Savior. He lives, and you ask me how I know He lives, because He lives in my heart. Stand together with me and let's sing He Lives this morning.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my
we're going to get better on that. Let's try it one more time. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. What a good day to be here on Resurrection Day, this Sunday, the 31st of March. It's a blessing, absolutely blessing to be here. You know, throughout the course of the week, we've had studies on a variety of different things, on that triumphal entry of our Savior Jesus when He entered into Jerusalem on that donkey's colt, and was worshipped as king. And then we see on that Thursday, as He institutes the Lord's Supper, and as He goes then to be betrayed, arrested, and then denied. And then on Good Friday, the day when the very same people that had worshipped Him as King of Kings and Lord of Lords turned their backs on our Jesus and said, "Crucify Him. Crucify Him." And He was unjustly beaten. He was unjustly tried to the point where He wasn't not even recognizable any longer. And then He carried His cross to the point of death, and He gave His life for you and for me.
Amen.
But then, just as He said was going to take place, just as He knew was going to happen, just as was the will of God, not only to turn His wrath on His Son, Jesus, but then to also complete redemption by resurrecting Him from the grave. And that's what we celebrate today. You know, on that first resurrection day, after Mary Magdalene had gone to the tomb early that day to go and check and help take care of the body, she saw that the tomb was empty, and she ran back and went to Peter and to some of the other disciples, and they went to check, and they found the tomb was empty. And then going back, Mary stood, it says in verse 11, weeping outside the tomb, and she wept. She stooped down and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know him, and I do not know where they laid him." Then, having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she didn't know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to my Father, and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." What a beautiful account. The first account in the scriptures of Jesus appearing to somebody after the resurrection. Throughout the scriptures, we have a variety of those accounts, but of all, in all that we have in scripture, we know that he appeared to over 500 different people after his resurrection. These people who had seen him die and now seen him alive. What an incredible blessing. You know, radical movements have started on much, much less than that. But God had a plan. And his plan was that this work of Christ was eternal. It was going to last through the ages, from generation to generation. And here we are today, 2,000 years removed, celebrating the defeat of death, the victory that we have in Jesus. And isn't that such a blessing? Our God, Yahweh, come to earth for you and for me, to give his life, to defeat sin, and to defeat death, so we can have that victory in him. Let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for the blessings of this day. We thank you, Lord, for the way you are working in and around us. And Lord, I pray today that as we have heard this first eyewitness account of Jesus appearing to Mary, Lord God, I pray that we would continue to see more and more and hear more and more about the truth that Jesus, he's real. He gave his life. He died for me. He died for these that are here. He loves us so much. We pray now that you be honored and glorified in our praise. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
sing Because He Lives. Stand together. Let's sing it. Because He Lives. Sing it with all your might, church. Because He Lives, I can face another tomorrow. Amen. Sing it out.
God sent His Son.
Saves us and nothing else. But oh, we thank you for Sunday, the day that you arose. We serve a risen Savior, and we thank you for that today. We know you're here with us. The Holy Spirit is obviously here. We thank you for your presence today. I pray most of all, if someone does not know this Savior that we have just sung about,
May they come to know the best friend they'll ever have. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done already. We give you praise and glory. Everything that comes out of this place, may it always praise and glory and honorify nobody but the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for this offering. Use it for your honor and glory and to help us further the ministry here for your kingdom's sake. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Children and youth, if y'all would come on the stage, Pastor John's going to help me. We're going to arrange around these microphones, and we're going to sing a little bit this morning. Is that okay? All of our youth, obviously, I want the little ones in the front, youth, you behind them, okay?
Watch you too.
And y'all split. You know how to do that? Some of you on this side, some of you on that side, okay? There we go. Y'all pretty smart. Some of you. Gather around the microphone there. Y'all gather around the microphone. All right, preacher, you're going to sing this with us, okay?
Yes, I am.
Yes, you are. Yeah. Do y'all know what gather around the microphone meant? Lucas, come up here. You talk. Come up here.
What?
Walk over here. Walk behind the Lord.
You stand right here.
There we go. All right. Y'all look pretty this morning.
Thank you.
Some of you look handsome. All right. We'll be right back.
resurrection. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. Hey! I believe in the crucifixion. By his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his life is destiny. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name, I hope of heaven, he's preparing a place for me.
Bible says, my king is the king of the Jews. He's the king of Israel. He's the king of righteousness. He's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of glory. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. I wonder, do you know him? My king is a sovereign king. No means of measure can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captive. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he purifies the weak. I wonder if you know him. He's the key to knowledge. He's the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of deliverance. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is light. I wish I could describe him to you. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. Well, you can't get him out of your mind. You can't get him off of your head. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Terror couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him. And the grave couldn't hold him. Yeah.
Friday, isn't it? It brings a little bit of pep, a little bit more excitement onto the screen here rather than the sadness and the sorrow. You know, we serve a living God. A living God. There is no God beside him. It's really easy for us to say certain things like, well, all the other gods of the world, there are no other gods. There's false idols. There's false gods. Jesus is exclusive. As Savior, it is him. There's no other way. And you might say, well, you know, Pastor, that sounds awful narrow-minded of you. Then what are all these other people across the world attempting to do? Well, see, their God wasn't powerful enough to rid them of sin or powerful enough to give them an eternal home. So they are constantly working in order to satisfy a God that is standing over them and lording over them and saying, you're not good enough. You have to do this more. You have to act like this more. You have to say this prayer so many times. You have to stand in this dark room or kneel in this dark room with your face on the ground for day after day, after month. You have to do this, do that in order to seek my approval. We know such things in our own timeline of the fact that there are monks that are Buddhist monks that are overseas right now that are sitting in front of statues that are in the form of demons and have been there for days upon days upon days, that are breathing in smoke and incense and things like that in order to, and they're asking that they would be like that false deity that they are worshiping. Maybe you say, well, you know, I just can't picture that. That's hard to imagine outside of movies and stuff like that. Well, imagine this then. Imagine somebody so passionate about their faith that they're, because their mother came to them and said, I'm so disappointed in you. You haven't been living up to God's standard that he gives us in the book he left us. So because you haven't, I'm disgraced. And the only thing that you can do, is you can give your life in the name of Allah. By blowing yourself up at a train station or walking into a historical church and doing the same. Or getting into a car and driving into a group of children at a Christian school. Everybody's at a loss. No one can figure it out. Because they don't know Jesus. You say, well, Pastor still seems narrow-minded. How do you say that the God of the Bible is different than any other? Well, last week, I don't know if you remember me mentioning that there are thousands of cross-references in the Bible that was written over the course of 3,000 years, both Old and New Testament. But not only that, none of them contradict each other. From beginning to end, every bit of it points to humanity's need for a Savior, God's provision of a Savior, redemption, and grace. See, that's important for us to understand, that within itself, there's no conflict. But really, there should be, because that diversity in the way that it was written in three different languages by so many different authors to prove one point, that we needed Jesus. And then to show us how great his work was. But if that wasn't enough, think about the fact that Jesus, of all those who came before him and all those who will come after him claiming to be the Christ, Jesus is the only one who fulfilled all the Old Testament prophecies for the first coming of the Messiah. So much so, if you don't believe me, ask your Jewish friends to show you their Hebrew Bible and see where it's been taken out of the Hebrew Bible. Because they don't want their people to see that Jesus is the one who fit it. Look for Isaiah 53 or Micah chapter 5, Isaiah chapter 7. Look for these key pivotal passages that are prophecies some 600 to 700 years and even beyond that said what Jesus was going to be like when he came and what was going to take place in his life. And they have taken it, robbed it from their very own scriptures. Well, as if that's not enough. Here in the scripture, we see that there are over 500 different eyewitnesses of Jesus coming. Not only that, but there are people who resurrected that are walking around. The veil tore. The world went black in midday in the moment that he died. There was an earthquake. Even the Jews were believing. Even the Romans were believing that he truly was the Son of God. And they continued on. But if you're not even going to believe that, then think about this. Why would there have been such an extensive search by Rome and by the nation of, or the Hebrew nation, for his body? When it could not be found. You know, historically, they said that they looked for over a year for him, thinking that it had been grave robbers. They were never able to find him. Why? Because he ascended, just like he said earlier, to God the Father, who is not only his Father, but our Father, not only his God, but our God as well. There's a lot of proof. There's a whole lot of proof. And you could say, well, you know what, Pastor? The Bible's an old book. It's old. I mean, some of this was written, or is speaking of events, thousands and thousands and thousands of years old, but some of this was written by Moses five books were. And it just continued on. It's an old book, but did you know that of all the ancient books in all of the world, we have the most, we have the closest to the original manuscripts of any books by over 1,700 years. So let me explain. When Paul wrote Galatians, that we know that was one of the first of his letters, written sometime around 60 AD. So when he was writing Galatians, and he signed it sometime around 60 AD, Paul, I don't know how they did that, and he started passing it around. That means that we have manuscripts that are closer to that original document by 1,700 years, because we have some that are just about 60 years removed from that original. Homer's Iliad, that's never questioned. It's never questioned. 2,000-year-old manuscripts from the original signature copy. We have such accuracy in our word. But then, on top of all of that, every bit of it, all of it, there's more proof. There's proof in the power of the word. There's proof in the fact that God's word has power. And let me explain. You know what the Jewish people thought, right? And so did Rome. Rome thought that as soon as they killed Jesus, this whole radical movement would just dissolve. In fact, we see that at the beginning of this text of Scripture, don't we? We see, you know who goes to the tomb first? The women. They're faithful. They weren't afraid. They weren't all hunkered down up in a room like we're about to read, like the men were. No, the women went to the tomb, and they were going to go and continue the preparation of the body as they were supposed to do and as they had planned to do, and he was missing, right? But any radical movement that's ever taken place in all history, when you cut off the head, it dissipates. It disappears. There's no need for it. Folks, we're 2,000 years away, and we're still going strong. Why? Because there's power in God's word when he says that there is a promise to the church that it will always be everlasting. It will be eternal. We don't have to fear the end of the church. Why? Because we are eternal. We are going to be with him. There's no reason in the world why we should close the book and let it disappear and the church to fade. Why? Because there's power in its word. It's God's word. Perfect. It leads to righteousness. It points us to Jesus. The fact that in all of history, with martyrdom, we think at the turn of the first century with Nero in charge of Rome and all of these evils that were taking place. And if you don't know how evil Nero was, he was evil. In fact, much of what Hitler did, he did in a way to mirror Nero's reign because he thought that he was the ultimate superior leader. So when you hear tell of lamps being made out of body parts and things like that, Nero had begun that. He would use his lamp covers and such for out of body parts of Christians that he would have martyred. But yet they went willingly. I have a book in my office full of stories of martyrs, and each one of them went with joy, praising the Lord the whole way. Don't you think that it would have fizzled out if this wasn't real? If that wasn't enough. 2,000 years later, we're considered to be at a point in time in history where slavery is greater, persecution and martyrdom are greater than ever. Right now. You think, wow, that just doesn't make sense. You know, I'm wearing a nice suit, even though when I was pushing my foot through my pant leg this morning, I literally ripped the cuff out with my toe. So don't pick on me, but it is the right one. You can all look at it when you walk out because I was a little embarrassed, but I was in a hurry. You know, we all dressed nice this morning, didn't we? Anybody in here hungry? If you're hungry, we'll feed you afterward, okay? We're not having a formal meal, but I'll make sure you are. Nobody in here is hungry, okay? I've seen hungry, and nobody in here is hungry. If you've eaten a meal in the last week, you're not hungry. Okay? So that being said, when you think about it for just a moment, we have it pretty easy, don't we? Who in here had to think about what car to take to church this morning? Yeah, how about that? Who in here had to think about what you're going to do for breakfast or what you're going to do later on? You know, do you have enough money to both drive home and eat? Yeah, praise the Lord, huh? You see, we don't know what poverty's like. We don't know what being without is like here. But there's places in this world right now where Resurrection Day is being worshipped in the woods, hiding, because they have no freedom to do it where they live. And if they did, they would be drug out in the streets and beaten and put in prison or even killed. Martyrdom is at such a rise right now. Did you know that the modern missionary is being told to arm themselves? Because they're not just coming in like they used to and putting people in prison, but they're beating the husband or the man until he's unable, and then they rape the children and women in front of the man, and then they kill them all. That's what it looks like these days, folks. Do we realize where we are? Listen, but people are passionately pursuing missions still. They want to go. They want to reach unreached people. Why? Because the Bible says in Revelation chapter 7 that in that day that there will be people from every tribe, tongue, and language group around the throne room of God praising his name. That's why we have passion to continue on. That's why, because there's power in this word. There's power in the gospel. That's why we can say with confidence, as Paul said, that I'm unashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God to salvation to all who would believe. You see, we have no reason to be afraid. We have no reason to be ashamed. Why? Because Jesus is Messiah. He did the work. We don't have to be scared. But here today, what we're going to do is we're going to find where these disciples are in a place, they're kind of hiding out. It's a Sunday morning, first day of the week, the Lord's Day, okay? Sunday morning, first day of the week, the Lord's Day, and they're all kind of huddled together, hiding. We find them doing this quite often, don't we? Well, we're going to see what happens then in what Jesus tells them. We're going to see that power of what the power of salvation really is. Because if you're in here and you're following Jesus, there is nothing to fear. There is nothing to fear. So let's take a look at this real quick. And I encourage you to turn to John chapter 20, beginning in verse 19. I am going to, if you're able, please stand for the reading of God's word. It says, on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were, for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and he stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. Get up, right? Stop hiding here in fear of the Jews. I told you what I was going to do. God's sending me. He's sending you too. Get up and go. Right? And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, you are forgiven them. They are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. Let's pray. Father, as we enter into this text of Scripture, I pray, Lord, that we would be able to have it fully exposed to us. Lord, everyone in the room, regardless of where we've come from this morning, regardless of our walk in life, well, God, I pray that you would expose the truth of this scripture to each one. And that, Father, hearts would be softened within this room. And folks would be seeking to better understand, who is this Jesus? Whether they've been a Christian for 60 years, for 20 years, for 10 years, for no years, Lord, I pray that we would come to a deeper understanding of who you are and what you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may take a seat. So, the first thing that I want to point out from this first verse is that the power of salvation gives us reassurance and purpose. Reassurance and purpose. Mary Magdalene, she had come in verse 18 and she makes an announcement. She went and announced to the disciples, "I've seen the Lord." And that he said these things to her. She told them exactly what he had said to do. She obeyed Jesus, which is very, very important. And then what takes place? They're still hiding out. They're afraid. Their leader had just been brutally beaten. And if you understand, and I know that those videos are gruesome, but I think it's good to have a good idea of what actually took place with Jesus. You see, when Pilate first got him, after he had already been beaten pretty well after meeting with Caiaphas and the others, what he would do is he would give him lashes with one less than what would kill him. And he thought that would suffice. He thought they would now say, okay, you know what? Look at him. He looks pretty awful. Because it wasn't just that. They would take the cat of nine tails and they would dip it into a glue, kind of like our modern day rubber cement or a tar. And then they would dip it in shards of glass and stone and things like that and bone, chips of bone. And then they would beat somebody with it. And they would beat him. And so it's 32 lashes would be one that would kill. So 31 lashes. And they would actually, when they would hit, they'd put it in, and they'd pull it across, and it would just tear through. It's violent. It's terrible. And it's what Jesus did for you. You know, so the last time they'd seen him, that had happened. They had seen him mocked, spat on. They put the purple robe over him so the blood would dry to it and then ripped it off. Could imagine how that would feel. They had seen all this take place. They saw him, a man that was strong, a carpenter, and they saw him then who couldn't even carry his own cross the entire way because he was so weakened. That didn't happen, church. Everybody carried their cross. He was so beaten. He was at such a weakened state compared to those who were typically crucified that they brought him to that point of death and somebody else had to carry it for him. And they saw Jesus nailed to a cross, drawing every breath, having to pull himself up in order to breathe and then drop back down. I mean, how long could you last doing that, right? Some of us, it's hard to sit up in bed. That was what they saw last. That's how they saw their Savior, the one that they had been following and dedicating their lives to. No wonder they were hiding. Huh? Let me ask you something. If today, in the middle of the service, somebody came in from the government, state government, federal government, whatever, and gave me a piece of paper and said, "This has to be read at the church. From now on, you are not allowed to gather in this facility. You are not allowed to have your own Bible. You're not allowed to have worship. You're not allowed to tithe. You're not allowed to serve. You're not allowed to teach. You're not allowed to, if you do teach, it can be online, but it has to only be specific things. You're not allowed to say this is a sin. You're not allowed to say that is a sin. You're not allowed to do this. You're not allowed to..." How many of us would just go home and cower? What did Paul do? When Paul was stoned to the point of death out in the yard for preaching Christ in the synagogue, they thought he was dead. They all went back into the synagogue. Paul gets up, all covered in blood from being stoned, and walks back in and continues to preach. Wow, that's something, isn't it? But you see, that's what the power of salvation holds. It holds reassurance and purpose. That even with seeing Jesus, even with the good news that Mary had seen him since the resurrection, they're still up there hiding out of fear. Remember how I said that there is nothing to fear? Fear is evil. When it encroaches, it destroys. It holds us back. And here they are, being destroyed and held back. But what does salvation do? It brings reassurance and it brings purpose. Reassurance, first, what? In Jesus' words, saying that on that third day he would rise again. The disciples seem to have forgotten that, haven't they? Because of everything that they've experienced. You know, I'm a deer hunter, and I'm not going to get gruesome, but there's been a few times You know, every time I shoot a deer, typically I walk up to it, and it's dead. You know, it's how it's supposed to be. Eyes open and everything. Get ready to get to work then. So all that said, one day I walked up to one, its eyes were closed, and I thought, well, that's weird. Maybe it fell asleep. I was on the phone with Ruth. I dropped the phone because it stood up. Just stood up, and it was big. It was bigger than I thought. It scared me a little bit. I thought, I can't outrun it. And he looks like he means business. It was not what I expected, right? See, they expected Jesus to be in the grave still. They had forgotten the promise. They now had reassurance in that, which leads to purpose. So Jesus' words here, they encourage the frightened disciples. This is across the board here. We see them in this scared state when he says, peace be with you. That was the first thing he needed to say. He needed to say, peace, like relax a little bit. Calm down. It's going to be okay. So what did they do? First of all, when they encouraged these frightened disciples, it shows that there's peace in his presence. It's like you could suddenly breathe. Like everything's going to be okay. Jesus is here. The second thing is reassurance of their commission. Because I'm pretty sure that immediately after he walks in and says, peace, they all of a sudden are now like, oh, we just are so busted because we're hiding and Jesus has got here, you know? Oh, this is not good because he told us to go into the nations and tell them about Jesus and we're afraid and hiding. So while there is peace, there's also, we're about to get a talking to. But then there's also hope in that. Because the last time they saw him, there was no hope. They had forgotten all hope. But there's hope when they saw Jesus. Paul says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 4, it says, when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. What better hope is that than to know that when Christ was our life, let's say the disciples see him, all of a sudden they see Jesus, they know it's all going to be okay. That's how they feel. That's how they are expressing their emotion. And they want to let other people know that they saw Jesus. So we see that. Then we also see the power of our salvation fills us with the Holy Spirit. I know that I oftentimes criticize the church and say, hey guys, you know what? We have struggled a little bit here as far as our, what? Showing that we are truly full of the Holy Spirit, doing what we're called to do. He says, when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. He's giving them all this reassurance. Then he says to them, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I'm sending you. Then he's saying, go. It's time for you to go. It's time for you to get off your behinds, stop being afraid, and go. But he knows that they can't be left alone. So he breathed on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. This is the second time God does this. The first time is when he forms Adam in the garden. He breathes his life into him. A very exclusive way of creating God's crowning act of creation, which was man and woman. He didn't do that with anything else, but he breathed life into Adam. And now he's doing that again to these fearful disciples. There's times when we need that life breathed in us, isn't there? When we are down, when things are hard, and we're like, God, we need you now more than ever. And what does he do? He comes to our aid. That's the beauty of the power of our salvation, is we're not left alone because we have the work of the Spirit of God in us. This is a unique phrase in what he says here in this entire picture that we see to John's gospel. It's promised six times in his gospel of the coming of the Holy Spirit. And he promised us during the commission that we would be equipped and empowered. We'd be ready to go. That's good. But he breathed the Spirit of God into them and said, hey, quit sitting around, quit being afraid. But you know what? Jesus is here right now, right? It's really easy to do that. It's really easy to be bold when we got Jesus here. It's really easy to be tough I had a, when Ruth and I first got married, we moved into our first house, and we got a puppy. It was a black lab mixed mutt thing named Hunter, and he was real tiny and cute. And one time, I was walking on the back porch, and it was super, super late at night, and I was kind of standing at the steps like this on the back porch. I was ready to go to bed, and he had gone down to go potty, do his thing. And I'm standing there, and all of a sudden, he bolts back towards me like in total fear. And this huge owl had landed right on the fence, right where that first pew is from me, and I didn't see it. I'm looking at him, you know. It landed there. Well, Hunter, he saw it. And he ran up, and he sat right down between my feet and looked up at that bird like, yeah. Come on. I was scared to death of the owl. I'm not going to lie. It was big, and, you know, I know owls are tough, too. So I grabbed him, and we ran inside, and, you know, it was okay. You could potty in the house tonight, Hunter. Let's go, you know, kind of deal. But isn't there something to be said about the idea that there's times when we feel more courage because other people are around us, right? I mean, so why, when we have God's Spirit in us? Maybe it's courage to avoid sin, but when we're by ourselves, we sin like crazy. Maybe it's courage to share the gospel when we're in groups of people or on a mission trip or something like that, but when we're out shopping or when we're in a group that we're not really quite certain of, we're afraid to do it, and we get quiet. Why is that? When we have God's Spirit dwelling within us, who gives us unction and purpose and drive. Why is that? I think it's that we've gotten so used to trying to live on our own, and all the luxury that I mentioned earlier that we have as 21st century American Christians, that we kind of put the Spirit of God to the side and say, we got this on our own. It's not up to us. And then we also see that we have, within the power of our salvation, they were given the power to forgive sins. You say, uh-oh, here we go. I was hoping we wouldn't actually go to chapter 23. Pastor, don't you know on Easter there's a lot of people who visit the church? Why would you do this? Well, I think it's important for all of us to know that there is authority within the church. I think it is. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. And if you will withhold forgiveness of any, it is withheld. So you say, wow, who would ever withhold forgiveness of sins? That's terrible, right? I mean, if we left it up to children, little ones, you know, they might say, well, that person over there, they took such and such from me. They're not forgiven. Whew. But we don't do that, right? We want everybody to know Jesus. We want everybody to be forgiven. Years ago, there was an older pastor. He was close to passing away. He was even on hospice care. And he confessed sins to me and said, do you forgive me? I said, yes, I forgive you and I love you. And so does God. Trust in his forgiveness. Seek him. This is literally the priesthood of believers painted out by Jesus, letters written in red, saying you as believers can what? Bring peace to. There's authority within the church. You have that opportunity. Now there's other authority as well, right? There is not only apostolic authority that we see here, but there's other authority that falls within the church, like church discipline, like worship, like baptism, like the Lord's Supper, like missions, like, you know, being a place where preaching or the exposition of Scripture takes place. You know, these things are all important, right? Those are things that are important. And in fact, you aren't supposed to do that once or twice a year. You're supposed to do that all the time, as often as you possibly can. Earlier, one of our faithful members and I were talking. He was like, when I grew up, we were at church all the time. All the time. That's the authority that's within the church. But here, he's displaying that by talking about forgiveness of sins. Why? Because it was something that had never been offered, ever. in all of history had never been offered. Christianity wasn't 2,000 years old. For somebody to say, yeah, pray to God and ask him to forgive you of your sins, and he will. In fact, the scriptures are one day going to say he's going to cast them as far as the east is from the west. The scriptures are also one day going to say if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you're saved. But none of that was written yet. They needed these guys to go out and to, when they heard the concern of others and when they shared the gospel, say, yes, your sins are forgiven. But they also were given the authority to determine who is being genuine and who is not. So I say today, very quickly, who in here is genuinely following Jesus? Who in here would stand up and even bear their cross to the point of death like Christ did? Friday night, my key verse was Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, that said, he endured the cross with joy. He did that for you and for me. And he was crucified on our behalf. We could not be crucified ourselves for forgiveness of sins. No, 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 no. We've been crucified alongside Christ. Therefore, we no longer live, but Christ lives in us. You see, this is the importance of the gospel. That we trust every bit of the power of salvation and the power of having the Spirit of God dwelling within us. Do you believe that? Are you genuine in your faith? Will you step out on faith and trust God? Because let's be honest, there's nothing else in this world that has ever offered forgiveness freely. They might say, hey, if you're good enough, or if you commit your life to this, or if you allow yourself to die for this cause, then you can have some kind of forgiveness or some kind of eternal security. But only in Jesus, only in Jesus is the power of salvation complete. Trust and believe today. We're going to have a time of invitation here in just a moment. If anybody in here does not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and you feel the desire and the draw of God to come forward, I encourage you to come up and let's have a conversation. Let's talk about it. Don't be afraid. Don't be hesitant. Be bold. Be strong. There's not a soul in here that's going to look at you and go, oh my goodness, I can't believe they're going up. No, nobody. In fact, if anybody does, then I'll talk to them too. That's the authority of the church. But let me tell you something. Don't wait. Don't wait. Don't wait till that time when it's too late and you've died and now you know that it was all true. Trust God today. If anybody in here is looking for a church home and today is the day, during this invitation time, I encourage you to come forward and join this wonderful faith family. We'd be glad to have you. But let's be genuine in our faith, church, because he is risen. He is risen. That was good. That was good. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this time, and we thank you for each one that's here, Lord, coming truly to worship you. And I pray, Father, now that as we enter into this time of invitation, that your will would be done in an incredible way, that you, Lord, would work in the souls of each one here, and that, Father, they would come forward humbly seeking you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus paid it all to him we owe, amen. You come as the Lord leads you this morning as we sing.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And indeed I part. And thine alone can change the leper's spot and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. For Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, and my lips shall still repeat.
Sing it out, church. Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. Amen. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Amen.
Well, this morning we have quite a few that have come forward. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Dwayne come on up here first in order of who I spoke to here. You all know Dwayne Woosley. I know well. He really needs no introduction. He has been a faithful participant here for some time, even helping teach Sunday school classes and preaching on Good Friday. Dwayne is a retired pastor who's been in the area for, 10 months? Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
For about 10 months, and been visiting with us. His wife is currently homebound, unfortunately unable to be with us this morning, but she also wishes to come and be part of the fellowship of the church, so that's great news, and we're glad to have him here today. Who was here Good Friday? Yeah. Who enjoyed that message?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, not everybody that was here raised their hand. But he did a fantastic job, and it's a pleasure to be able to partner with him in the ministry. And just so you know, one of the things that I'm trying to do as well is, and I met with Dwayne and another one of our ordained men here at the church, is I want to build a network of these ordained guys, whether they're serving in a parachurch ministry or retired, to kind of come around me and help in a variety of ways, where it's iron sharpening iron, bouncing ideas off of them, having them as accountability, but then also when, hey, you know what, I don't want to preach 17 times this week. I do, but I didn't have time to prepare. Dwayne, can you do Good Friday? I'll never forget when I was in student ministry, I thought, I want to preach an Easter Sunday so bad, or Christmas, or something like that, and I never had the opportunity, and so I went to him and I said, you know what, you're retired now. I want you to have the opportunity to still be able to do things like preaching on a Good Friday or Easter or something like that. And I said, would you be interested? He said, yeah. And he said, I've been retired for 10 months. That means you did it last year. kind of tricked me into that, Dwayne. But definitely glad to have him. I'm going to have him stay up here. And then I'm going to, if you just come over here, we'll make some room. I'm going to have Michelle and CJ come up first. Y'all come on up here. There you go. It's Brazington, right? Okay, we're missing a... Okay. All right. Well, this is Michelle and CJ Brazington. We're so glad that they are here today. They live in a neighborhood full of folks from Saluda River Baptist Church. And I first met her when you lived across the street from Miss Jean. And of course, Miss Ann and Mr. Nathan as well. And Miss Jean and Miss Ann and Mr. Nathan and Mr. Dean have had such a sweet impact with this family, and they have on them as well. And CJ has had a big impact on their lives, for sure. And couldn't help but get a little emotional when you stepped up, Nathan, remembering Miss Ann and his relationship. And that being said, it seems fitting that they're coming forward today also to join by letter, both of these joining by letter from sister churches. But that being said, I'm really excited to have you all come and join the church as well. And they've already been pretty active, part of things around here, coming and helping and doing and serving and working. And that doing all that, putting pine straw out and blowing everything off, right, CJ? Did a good job. Yeah, painting the mailbox. But definitely awesome to have you two come up here. And we're going to go ahead, and I want to just say all of those in favor of these two coming by, these really four coming by transfer of letter, let it be known by saying praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Then Mr. Dean, I want you to come on up. It's a little more difficult for you to stay up here for a long period of time, but he's tougher. He's tough. Yeah. Come on up here, my friend. Mr. Dean came up here this morning saying he wanted to rededicate his life to the Lord. He was planning on coming up anyway in support of his neighbors here, but Mr. Dean said that he needs some patience, and with his family, with his friends, he needs to exhibit that in loving kindness, and he knows that that comes from the Lord. And so with all that entails, he's been through a lot. He's battling cancer, battled it, what, about 8 months ago as well, 6 to 8 months ago, and been through a lot. We need to be praying for him. But, y'all, it's such a blessing to know that he's coming up and saying, you know what, I'm not going to play games anymore. Yeah, I'm going to seek the Lord. And that's good. That is so good. But we love you, and we're proud of you for coming up. And I'm not going to make you stand up here unless you want to. If you want to sit down right there, what we do traditionally is, after this, if you would come and welcome them, let them know how grateful you are for their decision to come join the church, but then also his to follow Christ in a deeper way. It's truly a blessing to be able to have all of these come up, and God's really working in an incredible way. He really is. That's good. Mr. Dean, if you want to go ahead and sit down, I'm going to make y'all stand up. Y'all are all good for a minute. Excuse me, Michelle.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I have a couple of quick announcements to make. I said I wasn't going to go long today, and I kept looking at that evil clock in the back. It was proving me a liar. All right, so this being said, a couple things coming up. One is, there is nothing midweek this week here. It's spring break. We have folks traveling, everything else. So stay home. If you want to do something, spend time with family, friends, do something like that. And go out and enjoy yourself. But we're not going to be having midweek Bible study. Our lunch that we would typically have on the first Wednesday is going to be the 10th, the second Wednesday. So I encourage you to be part of that. Also, a lot of things going on. Everybody that's here today, even if you don't usually come here and you have another church, you're here with family, whatever else, I encourage you. We're doing the shoebox challenge, that every person at this church would provide one Operation Christmas Child shoebox. That is a Christmas present for children and unreached people groups across the world. There's description on what is needed for those boxes as you walk out on the left. I encourage you to pick one of those up. And if every individual at the church would do that, it would be an incredible, incredible feat. And with all the folks we have here visiting today, what an awesome thing that would be. So I encourage you to do that and see how God works through that great, great ministry. I do encourage you, read your bulletins. We have a lot of other things coming up, and make sure you stay ahead on that. We're going to close out a little differently than usual. Dwayne, I'm going to ask you to take over from here, brother.
All right. Well, we're going to do something a little different. We're not going to have a benediction prayer. This will be our benediction. When we're done, you come shake these folks' hand and shake our hands on the way out. Have a great week. If you need anything this week, give us a call. We're here to serve you, okay? Well, we're going to do something a little different. Would you stand together? I don't know if you like your neighbor or not, but grab their hand. And if you're sitting on the end of the aisle on each side, would you reach across the aisle and grab your neighbor's hand? I can't think of a better way to leave, but everybody knows this chorus, than to sing, He is risen from the dead and He is Lord. Amen. Let's sing it together. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is all. Oh, we can do better than that. Come on, church. He is Lord. He has risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen, amen. God's people said amen. Thank you for coming to Saluda River today. You are dismissed.